Rusty Miller was born in La Jolla and raised in San Luis. He graduated with a degree in history from SDSU in 1964. He was United States champion in 1965. He was captain of the United States team to the World Championships in 1966, twice the finals in the Duke Carmichael Invitational in 1967 and 1968. In 1971, Rusty was the first to ride Uluwatu, the Great Wing Bali, which is now surfed by a quarter of a million people each year. Rusty was seen in films across three decades and is the surfer in this iconic image that went on to feature across the country on a Hams beer commercial. The surfer scratching up the face here is self-confessed 4 foot and under man, Mickey Dora from Melbourne. That's what was going through his mind as he was going over the face. What I think is really interesting is the placement of the product that Hams chose when they put this billboard together. I don't know if we would have approved of that. Rusty was the first commercial producer of Surfworks in a company called Surf Research. So it's fitting you should speak for the Center for Surf Research. According to surf historian Matt Marshall, while at San Diego State University in the 1960s, Rusty would occasionally attend surfer parties dressed in a tweed jacket and loafers, took the smoking pipe and tried with little success to engage other surfers in conversation about art, politics and world affairs. So Rusty, it's taken a while, but San Diego State is now ready to embrace your intellectual side.
I don't think I'd shout because I think right before I passed away, I went to several of the events, one of them being a president of the union in Costa Rica. And Mickey said, I wish I would be, been on the wave instead of paddling out, And so I was too bad. And it was real symbolic that we put a beer over him because I was sort of like, I think that was the thing that cracked him almost. And he was just so mad about commercialism and surfing. In those early years, and of course, there's nothing compared to what commercialism and surfing is now. So, anyhow, the other thing he said, oh, yeah, that's too bad. He said, the size of the wave, he said, you're going straight off. Distinguished people who didn't really know who was going to be. I didn't know it was going to be a bunch of white covered academics. But interesting to run into my old friend John Baker, John Dahl, who bought Surf Research, myself, Mike Dahl, and Garth Murphy, a friend of mine, was taking them to great entrepreneurial heights. And it's lasted all these years. So, congratulations to I was fortunate living in San Luis where growing up there, and the old lifeguards and watermen who I grew up under tended to be broad, pluralistic, and very progressive. Think of California City pools such individuals in the 50s and 60s, with a mainstream perception picture people on the beach times. So I was impressed. And all these guys were all rounders, looking at those fish, lobsters, abalone, out of the ocean, blue hats to the sun, like the Tahitians and the Hawaiians that taught them on their travels to these places. They could sail, play, play music, make their own music. They put that Tahitian and Hawaiian music over their loudspeakers sometimes. They could cook, they could have fires on the beach. They could hunt fish, build houses, speak the ways and ideas and philosophies of different indigenous peoples in the Pacific and learn from them. These were original surf travelers, and they had a great respect for the society they visited. As I was attending classes here in 63, 64, surfing really started as a subculture, just beginning to treat the public consciousness. Being associated with all these interpretations like the beach party movies, the image of surfers, socially disrespectful. Is that right? Socially disrespectful and radical. You can imagine people taking their service with that on. Is that right? Was portraying much of what we really didn't want to project to surf. So clubs like the one I was involved in, unfortunately, like the Women's Surf Club, were very involved in changing our image. So one original event we put on was a certain session for blind people, which is quite interesting. It was the Junior Foundation for Blind. We did some programs for cancer research and some good things to show people that we weren't all crazy, irresponsible people. Just standing at a certain spot, I think, introduced me to how hard it was to work to change public perceptions. I must have got sort of locked in and twisted, and I think just to show a good example of that from the beginning of the meeting here today. But the event I remember most from San Diego State University was when John F. Kennedy spoke here in 1963 at the graduation exercise. His motorcade winding down into the Aztec Bowl. His powerful speech he was giving our nation a sort of positive dream just before we got sucked up in the mess of Vietnam. And I thought the directions that we could have taken as a nation state. And in some ways, because we did live on the things like the Peace Corps, which is close to what we're talking about. Then, his exit by helicopter. He got in his helicopter and rose on the stage, and we all sort of aghast. This great man, his amazing ideas, lifted in the air. I love the atmosphere here because I could find people to talk to regarding these issues. There's a great ruin and respect for the humanities at this university. And one evening, when I was attending a fraternity recruitment party, and I just actually was pretty excited ideologically because I just received a name on some paper and got on Players Republic. I ran into a friend that just returned from my trip around the world on the University of the Southern Seas. As you can see, it said laboratory of the world. The world is our laboratory. It was a university I should have traveled around the world, and I thought then that there could be, I could be an academic, I could travel around the world, and I could serve. So the sentence's motto was, our laboratory is the world, our responsibility is to know the planet, Earth, and its people. Very progressive institution for that time. It was run out of Chapman College in Orange. It's also dedicated to the study of man. His, or even say hers in those days. His spiritual outreach, his physical resources, and the management of his environment. Interesting words for those times. Also, this is the time where I just read Rachel Carson's, another reading, Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, which is a milestone book about the environment. So its mission was to serve the people of the world, whose views permit them to pursue an unremitting search for knowledge. Accept an unbiased understanding of each other's problems, and use their capacity for furtherance of man's goodwill towards man. This took me on two voyages around the world in 1965 and 66. I had a surfboard with me. In fact, it was a two-part surfboard. It was made by Don Hansen, and he also helped me with the trip. At each port, there was an opportunity to serve, and I took it. I served in Tahiti, Haifa, Israel, Sri Lanka, Bay of Zion, before the 7-day war, Alexandria, Egypt, Portugal. When I returned from his voyages, it was really a good time for surfboarding. And beaches were thickening with enthusiasm, new surfers, boards, and acquiring intensity. The intensity more or less drove me to the water, because after everything was getting too bad. And yeah, it jumps out to 1979, where a friend of mine married an Australian woman. I grew up to Australia, was invited pretty much just after I got there to be in a film that's just about it. And that film became Morning of the Earth. How many people have seen Morning of the Earth? But how many people have heard of Uluwatu? We were staying at Kuta, the main Kentucky was on doing an adventure out to the Blue Chip Peninsula. Now, the Blue Chip Peninsula was this sort of ignored part of the island. It was dry, it was very poor, and it was in the southwest of the island. And he went out with a skirt to scout for some surf. He was out there, and as I said, it was also neglected by the government. And it was basically the subsistence farming, and they were extremely poor people. The next day, the four of us traveled out to the stage of the Bino, BW bus. And we were dropped off on a dusty road, a couple miles from the coast. We traced through the field as the sun burned down on us, and we were getting out of the Bino Valley. We had the sun in the middle of the day, which is sort of crucial. So then we traced through and towards the coast, and we ended up on a ridge overlooking this amazing series of perfect west. Couldn't believe it. So I needed to figure out a way to get down, of course. We followed a dry riverbed, which led us to the back of the cave. The locals were sort of speaking at us in the distance, but sort of hiding and very shy. And very shy to be in contact with us. And that's like being the first people in the place. That's amazing. So we're using a fisherman's bamboo ladder, which is a fisherman, obviously, on the trails down to the beach, to drop down into his teens, walk straight out front of the cave, and launch in his feet, and walk all the way out. Here's the dry, dusty trail. That's the other of the lady. I can never imagine the capacity to become a mecca for surf tourism and the movie become a cult film. And now my image of the guy on the left could be used on t-shirts or stickers and infinity. Very surprising. The valley has long since become the Hawaii of Australia, and it's still one of the highest, and of course, all over the world, people are going there all the time. Uluwatu is still one of the highest quality, most consistent way of producing roots in the climate. And immediately years after my initial trips there, I kept in touch with the community's development, mainly for Dick Crew, an Australian surf photographer, a filmmaker, who goes out every season. They always return. Visit the community. The immediate farm community, adjacent to the roof, started providing services to the growing visitation of whale hunters. Now the people who provide water, food, carry gear, and so forth begin to stay, ensure, actually prosper. They soon buy a motorbike, and then they economically put themselves up slowly but surely by this relationship with surfers. So many of the surfers are learning the language and therefore respecting the culture. They would bring clothes, provide extra funds to build accommodation, include infrastructures, and establishing lasting friendships for decades. A lot of them leave their bonds there every season and they came back. So this is even though the increasing discovery of the banner of this place brought more and more people, in the earlier times, the development was very well balanced. It was much more on the positive side. The contribution of wills because of economic improvement and other people's lives. Now, Valley made me believe in magic. It really did. It was so effective on me. I was dazzled by the magic of the animism and the connection to the pulse of the earth and surfers, real surfers, understand this. The real connection with nature. The surfer has that pulse of strata that comes from thousands of miles away and what is enlightenment traveling. Surfers began to work over the levels to obtain endorphins from exploiting not just the valuable resources they have, but this is the point, apply, an opportunity to engage, we can learn from the host community. Somewhere along the trail, we reached the point of diminishing returns. We've discussed this before, and this is what Surf Research Center is all about, the local community. And this is what's happening now, just not in the valley, but where I live, in Byron Bay, just on a little bit different level. Most likely, perhaps, if not each and every one of you here, because there is a gap somewhere in our lives. While this may be an auspicious day, may this faculty of Surf Research itself and support, will it be a lasting clue, is the clue to betray, and the eventual actualization of what we must do. It all comes back to the old Greeks and Socratic mantra, what is the right way to live? Well, I'm going to
Thanks very much, Rusty. Does anyone have any questions for me?
Still got that old single thing that was in the picture?
No, well done. Actually, interesting on that, I saw my kids a couple of years ago, he can use it, and he said, Rusty, that's my board. I mean, it's your board. It's part of the new tech. I mean, that's right. My board is brown. And actually, I borrowed that board from Henson and Gora, because Nikki and Gora, Nikki being not always organized in some of those books, he actually borrowed my surfboard. So my surfboard is the board that Nikki Gora is putting on that way. And the other board is my Henson surfboard, and that would be for the next session. Interesting things happen in history that we can use a lot. Any questions?
Rusty, real quick question. I imagine the time that you were in CUDA originally before you discovered Ulu, that it was, I know because I've been there as well, but it was way different than it is now. I mean, now it's a bustling hub. Back then it was a palm tree line kind of village. Are you satisfied by the way surfers have exploited the planet? Or
no, I think all the problems have been described very well here. I mean, it starts out, and I think I covered it pretty well. It starts out really gloomy, you know, the individualism, the respect goes back and forth, and somewhere along the trail, after a certain point, it's like a point of diminishing return, where it sort of spools over, and then you get a lot of people coming in that don't have the respect. It's sort of like backpacking in modern day. It started with every backpacker was a university graduate. So high, amazing, and then it got to the point now that so many people book backpacker facilities and get this sort of like backpacker visa. This is sort of got a lot of balance. So we've got to sort of stand up to the community and say, excuse me, we can't do that. We're going to call it up. So I think that's what the mission of this center is going to be in the future. And all these beautiful things. And by the way, I put up all these brochures of this amazing organization. So, Apple, and I didn't know it exists. And they're, wow. So I can say I'm gracefully surrender to the youth and what's happening in this world with the circle.
We have time for one more question.
This is more just about that trip, because I had the opportunity to go to Bali with my son 2 years ago. It was quite eye-opening. Scared the hell out of me some of those breaks, that's for sure.
Yeah.
8 years old. Do you happen to go way back then to Nusa Lambongan, by any chance?
I went there in the 80s with Keku, his original partner, Jack McCoy. And it was pretty new there, actually. By the way, I went to a couple of years ago with my wife, Tricia, if you want to. Checked in a hotel out there, had a lovely 9-foot pedestal and carbon fiber, walked down to the panel out, and it was just in the mass of the I saw this guy sort of paddle out and talk and sway and see the point. The sway is sort of like Jurassic Park, like monster trees, and that little nice animal turns into this monster. The wave is like, whoa! This is the first wave I took, and I just free fell on about a 10-foot wave straight down the ball. It's got one of the worst wipeouts I've ever had in my life. After 12. To say, oh no, that's not cool, it's also a great reminder of, what surfing is about, and you can be very, very humble. So, I love the way surfing reminds you of your humility, no matter what your name is. how much you can charge when you do so? Hello?
Second, one last question. Rusty, you're back here at SDSU after all these years. Have you joined the Alumni Association?
No. I have my pictures I got in front of the statue of Montezuma.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Can we thank Rusty Miller?